Greetings, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. I'm Caroline Staton, co-director of Transition US, and thank you for joining our online event. Our principal aim in providing these is to offer practical support to leaders of transition initiatives and those who are mulling over starting an initiative, and community leaders everywhere who are really working on resilience building within their communities. And we do offer these at no cost, but do ask that you consider making a donation. We have a donation button at the top bar of our website at transitionus.org. And thank you so much in advance to those of you who are able to do this. Let me introduce Cecile. She'll be doing some polls, asking some questions. She'll be speaking probably, you know, somewhere around 40 minutes, and we'll do a Q&A at the end. And, Cecile might break it up differently as we go. So I wanted to give you the background about Cecile, and also to let you know of her book that's come out, which is a really lovely book called Living Room Revolution, A Handbook for Conversation, Community, and the Common Good. It's really a lovely guide to a lot of great ideas and resources. So definitely, you know, pick that up if you can. And Cecile lives in a number of places. She lives in Seattle and in Santa Cruz, and is a member of the Walnut Commons Co-Housing in Santa Cruz. She's active in both the Transition Santa Cruz and Transition Palo Alto transition groups, as well as the one in Seattle. She has her doctorate in education from Stanford and has three other books dealing with the simplicity movement, Circle of Simplicity, Slow is Beautiful, and Less is More. So we have a real pro on our hands here with lots of tips and years of working on community-related issues. So very much look forward, Cecile, to you giving us some new tips and inspiration for our work in the transition movement and in other resilience-building efforts that we're involved in. So welcome, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Carolyn. And it's so nice to have Patrick and Barbara on this call, and they know that this is going to be hard for me because I can't see you and I can't have a conversation, and that's the most basic thing. So we'll try to have what we can do in a conversation, particularly at the end. But I did want to start out with a poll, and the question is, what do you think the state of community is in our culture? And on a scale of 1 to 5, 1 being the worst and 5 being the best, can you tell me what you think a community is like in this culture? So what do they do, Carolyn? They go ahead and press one of those?
They press 1 through 5 on their keypads. And just go ahead, and I'm sure this will be a piece of a conversation we'll be coming back to.
Right.
So,
right.
A few people haven't pushed, and maybe they joined by Skype, which sometimes doesn't allow for that. But again, if the state of community in our culture, 1 being the lowest and 5 being the highest, what do you think? Where do you think it's at? And what we have is we have 8% saying it's the lowest, 41% press number 2, 25% number 3, 8% number 4, and nobody pressed number 5, sort of the highest.
Usually there's one real optimist who does try to do that. But I think, obviously, we're going to be talking about this, and I really think it's one of the most important questions we can ask. And basically we'll be talking about today why I say that. And so I wanted to start with the fact that I think everybody who's on this call is concerned about making a difference. We want to do something about the problems. And we know about the problems, climate change, gun violence, wealth inequality, health care. And so probably a lot of us have asked ourselves, well, you know, what do we work on? And something happened to me several years ago, really, that kind of crystallized this for me about deciding the direction that I would put my energies. And It happened at our Seattle grocery co-op, Puget Consumer Co-op. And I say that because these sorts of things you wouldn't expect to happen in a co-op because nice people are in co-ops. And what happened, one day my husband and I were turning into the parking lot and we had to turn left, go across the traffic, and we were heading for a parking space, but we got stopped and we were holding up the traffic. So we saw this parking space, but we also saw that there was another woman who was interested in it. And she was just about to pull in it, but we were blocking traffic, and so we saw that she had another one. Anyway, so we pulled into hers. We pulled into that one. Well, in a few minutes, she got out, and she was furious. Now, obviously, she got a parking place because she was out, but she came up to us and said, "How dare you? You know, how did you? Why did you make this belong to you? That was my parking place." And we felt horrible. And so I tried to explain to her what had happened. And my husband, being wiser, had gone on ahead. And so I kept saying, you know, we saw that you had another parking place, and you know, we were blocking traffic. And so we got up to the front of the store, and we got our carts, and we're going to go in. And she took her cart and she crashed into me and yelled out, "Get out of the way, you bitch." And it was like, oh, my God, oh, my God. And, of course, the doors were open and everybody's in line at the cashiers. So everybody could hear her because she was yelling. And then the store manager runs up to me to see if I'm okay. And, of course, I burst into tears. But it was like afterwards I kept thinking, what happened there? And that wasn't a big thing. That was something small. But I thought, why did she do this? Why are we living on the edge like this? Why did she feel that that was her parking place? And this seemed to me to bring together all the issues that we have to have a change in our basic culture, that we have to move from this cutthroat, competitive culture to one that is compassionate and collaborative. And that really underlies all of the problems we're talking about, the climate change, the gun violence, wealth inequality. If we could change the culture, we can affect all of those things. Now, a lot of people will think, well, this can't happen. We can't change a culture. That's just doesn't happen. But our culture has changed in the past, and there's a new book out that I really like. It's by Steven Pinker from Harvard, and it's called The Better Angels of Our Nature. And he talks about how we've changed. And in particular, he says that we live in the least violent country, least violent times in all of history, not country, the least violent times of the whole world. And he shows how this is true, because it doesn't sound true. It doesn't sound true at all. But he particularly shows what happened in the medieval times, how, you know, a fun night would be for people to gather together down at the village square to burn a witch or to nail a cat to a tree and watch it. In other words, people took some sort of pleasure in that kind of experience. Well, he shows that we're no longer that way. That's not what we do. We don't revel in that kind. And I won't go into all the reasons except one basic one. But he says we have changed. And we all know that at one time people accepted slavery, and that's changed. And at a certain point, people accepted lynching, and that's changed. And so my point here, and Steven Pinker's point, is that cultures do change, and they can move in a direction of more caring, more collaborative. Other people will say, well, we can't change because of human nature. Human nature is basically, we can see that, it's greedy and selfish. And we've got new research that's helpful here, because it says, yes, human nature is greedy and selfish, but it's also capable of collaboration and compassion. That it depends on what the culture evokes, what the culture encourages. And we can see clearly that our culture evokes competition and selfishness. That's very clear. And so how do we move from that every man for himself to we're all in this together? What Steven Pinker found was we found ways throughout history to evoke empathy. And he particularly, I love this one, he said in the 19th century, people started reading novels. And that these novels allowed people to evoke to care about other people, and that changed things. And this really measures up with a lot of you know George Lakoff, and Berkeley linguist, and he says, if we want to bring about change, we must evoke empathy. We must give people experiences that build collaboration and caring. And as we give them these experiences, we begin to change the culture. And I think we can all see that this really is what transition is like. I think for me, transition more than anything helps us create these experiences that evoke empathy. It's caring and it's also understanding and giving people an experience to identify with others. So how do we do this? How do we evoke empathy? And a lot of us have discovered examples in transition. But some of us, and some of you on the call, particularly Barbara, we worked in the field of voluntary simplicity for many years. We felt that if we could help people live more simply, spent their time with things that really mattered, that they would move away from consumerism that hurt the environment, that helps cause global warming. So we really worked on voluntary simplicity, but too often, I would get the question, what is that thing you're involved in, that self-deprivation movement? And it was like, oh, no, we're talking and telling you about, how to really enjoy yourself in your life. This will improve your life. And so we started talking about less is more. That was one of my books that, if you have, if you spend less time shopping, you have more time for fun things. But somehow we couldn't get to people, I think, that this wasn't deprivation. So I think that deprivation does not work. The ideal of deprivation doesn't work in social change. That what you need to do is to find a way to inspire people, that people have to see that they're looking forward to something that's positive. And I saw the words of Saint-Exupéry. You remember him who wrote The Little Prince. And he said that if you want someone to build you a boat, you don't just give them the tools and the plans and the wood. He said, no. He said, what you do is you teach them to yearn for the vast and endless sea. And I love that. You teach them to yearn for the vast and endless sea. You give them a vision of what's possible. And you work toward, you help them figure out how to get to that vision, that people will say, help me get to that vision, because they see it as something positive. And so I've always, and other people have looked around, well, what is that vision? And I think some of us saw a movement that started that it just kind of spread around the world. And it was really kind of surprising. And if you see a movement that really does that, you have to pay attention. And it's the slow food movement that we all know about. And the thing about the slow food movement is, remember, it started kind of as a joke when McDonald's was moving into Rome, and they thought, oh, my God, what's going to happen if we have a fast food society? People come here because they want to slow down, and so they talk about the slow food movement. And what for me, the heart of the slow food movement is you're not supposed to be sitting alone in the dark, watching TV, eating something you just microwaved. No, you're supposed to be having dinner with other people and laughing and talking and eating good food, and from there you talk about how to care for the land and care for the planet. But it's this vision, I think, of the joyful community, that's essentially what's at the heart of what appeals to people about slow food. And so to me, this became what we have to work toward. And again, as I'll come back to and we'll talk about more, the transition really brings this, lets us work on this joyful community more than any other movement I've been involved in. And I always like to get involved in movements. But transition does this. And I think it's interesting that the happiness research that's going on right now backs this up. Because what does happiness research find? What is central to happiness? It's social connections, social ties, relationships with other people. And that goes over into how we view the fate of the world and climate change as well. So social connections are central to happiness. And one way to bring about cultural change is then to work to build community in a culture. And it's, you know, part of the subtitle of my book. But this is hard to do in this culture because we really have not learned to value relationships. It's interesting. I heard a psychiatrist say, you know, people will feel depressed and they will go to a psychiatrist, and what they usually get, you know, they'll get some sort of medication. But what is usually at the heart is loneliness. But that's not even a diagnosis in our culture. That's not even something that occurs to people. And one psychiatrist said that he wished he hadn't spent so much time talking to people about their problems with their parents, but helping people make more friends. And so, as we all know, what we've learned to value in this culture is money, that we have learned to feel that if we're rich, we'll be happy. And what we were trying to say in the simplicity movement is, no, 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 this isn't true. And now we have the research that shows it, that after a certain point, everyone needs a certain amount of money to have enough and have security. But after a certain point, more money does not give people more happiness. And in fact, it can undermine it, because it often undermines relationships. Because what happens is as we have a materialistic society, we focus on not the relationships, but getting more stuff. And then we start treating people as if they're objects to be manipulated. And so social cohesion, in fact, this is the big argument against wealth inequality. Wealth inequality undermines people's health. It is the biggest predictor, as some of you know, for longevity. A rich person in this country does not live as long as an average person in Denmark, where there's less inequality. And why? It's because, again, wealth inequality undermines social cohesion. So what we're saying is that we can talk to people about what will really make them happy, and then we can have this vision of the joyful community. And it's interesting, Gallup poll did a study not long ago of 151 countries. And they found that out of 151, we are 69th from the top. In other words, the higher the number, the worse it is. 69th on sadness. We're 74th on anger. We're 89th on anxiety. And 145th on stress. In other words, we're one of the most stressful countries in the world. And so what happens with this is we don't realize that happiness comes with social ties. So what do we do about this? Because the friendships have been going down. People have fewer friends than they used to have. We have to find a way, I think, to build what they're calling social capital. Now, a lot of we will think, like, social capital, that's a horrible thing to call it. It's like capitalism. But I like calling it that because it puts it up there with human capital, with physical capital. And I found a quote that I've always loved about it. It says, "We must learn to view the world through a social capital lens," says Lou Feldstein of the New Hampshire Charitable Foundation. "We need to look at front porches as crime-fighting tools, treat picnics as public health efforts, and see choral groups as occasions of democracy. We will become a better place when assessing social capital impact becomes a standard part of decision-making." And so a lot of you know about Putnam with Bowling Alone. He says that every organization should have a social impact statement, just as it has an environmental impact statement, that how is what you're doing creating more social capital. So the big thing is how do we begin on this? And it's conversation. It's interesting because conversation seems like, oh, God, you know, it's such a, you know, mundane thing. We all know about conversation. But conversation really is the beginning of community. And that John Dewey said that democracy begins in conversation. Putnam said that the culture in which people talk to each other over the back fence is the culture in which people vote. That conversation is really important. And so there are two kinds of conversation. There's the personal and the public. And it's interesting because I think we all realize that we need more conversation with friends and family. And, of course, part of the reason we don't have it is not that we don't think it's important, but that we don't have the time. And I think it's interesting, this is a whole other area of why don't we have time for this, partly our working hours, which is something else in the Simplicity Movement we worked on. But we felt that it's not just friends and family. It's also just as you go through your day. There's a book called Consequential Strangers that says, as you talk to people, as you go through the day, you're increasing your individual well-being and you're creating social capital. You're creating a civic involvement. And so some of you have heard me talk about the idea of stop and chats, that you need more stop and chats. And I got this idea from Larry David, who is the Seinfeld writer who did Curb Your Enthusiasm. And he says, you know, he hates stop and chats. If he sees somebody he knows, he'll walk across the street so he can avoid talking to them. But what I'm saying is that as much as you can, you say hello to people. You stop and chat. You ask them, you know, how they're doing. You smile at people. And this sounds like how could this be important? But what you're doing is that you're beginning to create a difference in the culture. You're beginning to help people feel that they belong, that they're cared for. I mean, think of the difference of that than going through the day where people are just scowling and they're just angry like that woman in the grocery store. You're being ignored. It creates feelings of bitterness and anger. And basically, you know, what do they say about those people who have massacred people? You know, they were loners. You know, I'm sure they weren't the people who had stop and chats. And so it's interesting to think about something as small as this, that they found that it is really very important. And then you can also, I think, have public conversation for social change. In other words, you're not just creating good feeling. You can actually make a difference in ideas. And I've come to think of this, first of all, I thought of grocery line activism. And I got that idea because my husband has these cute shorts that he wears made out of hemp, and people are always commenting on them. And one day I saw him in the grocery line, and people were saying, oh, I like your shorts. And he was saying, yes, they're made out of hemp. And the grocery line cashier was saying, yes, the corporations that won't let us grow hemp. And I thought to myself, he's got a little revolution going on right there in the grocery line. So I started thinking of grocery line activism, that whenever you can, you talk about things. And so I thought of, well, what other ways to do that? I thought of elevator ambush. And say, you know, you're carrying a newspaper with you, and you get on the elevator, and you say something like, oh, you know, why can't these people in Congress vote on gun registration? What is wrong here? What's going to happen? And then the elevator door opens, and you're off. So you don't have to deal with anything, but you've planted a seed. Then I thought about cell phone subversion. You know how people on the bus always talk really loud. Well, you can be talking on the bus, and you don't even have to be talking to anybody. You can just be saying, wow, you know, when are we going to do something about climate change? Did you see that storm in Oklahoma? Don't people realize that this is related to climate change? And then again, here comes your bus station, stop, and you're off. So you can bring up these things that are more difficult to talk about when you don't really need to go into depth. But in cafe conversion, you can start to talk to people. Many of the time I've been talking with friends, we talk in a louder voice, and people around us want to join in. And so you kind of watch to see, and then you invite them in, and you get to talk more about these issues. But I think one of my favorite ones is what I call small dog seduction. And small dog this seduction, you're walking around, and if you're a person who walks around with a button on, which I often do, that says something like, you know, move to amend, well, if people just see that out of the corner of their eye, they might think, oh, you know, I don't want to talk to her, she's going to rail at me about something. But if it's a small button and you have a small white dog, which is what I have, my little Bichon, people will stop and talk to you, and talk to your dog, of course, and think, oh, what a nice person you are because you've got this little dog. But they'll see your Move to Amend button and maybe they'll ask about it because now they trust you. So basically what I'm saying is that all of this, I think, leads to what I'm calling living room revolution, that we put a priority on conversation. We start bringing people into our living rooms. We throw out that old tyrant, the television, and reclaim our territory for conversation. And that it's not just that we do it in the living room, that we go on and we create the atmosphere of a living room wherever you go, that you want to be cordial, hospitable, caring, kind, enjoyable, all of these things to have more conversation. And I think that this leads to the importance of the forming of community, particularly in the form of the small group. And this small group throughout history has changed things. We know about the salons from the French Revolution, citizenship education schools and the civil rights movement here, consciousness raising groups or women's movement, that the small group of people coming together and consciously talking about issues is really the heart of social change. It's interesting, as an aside, this is also very good for your health. One study found that if you right now are not in a small group and you join one, you are cutting your chance of dying in half this next year. Now, you probably don't have much of a chance of dying, but this is a dramatic statistic that says small groups are really important. They've also found that the number of groups in a country is a big predictor for a responsive democracy, civic engagement, and they found this in Denmark where 95% of people are involved in a small group. So this whole idea of the small group, this, for me, it's something that I learned many years ago when I worked with the American Friends Service Committee, a Quaker group in the civics, in the civil rights movement in the 60s. Some of you know about Highlander Center. And Highlander Center was where Rosa Parks was trained, and its whole idea was bring people together to talk, and they will come up with the answers, and they will change, bring about social change. And Highlander Center still exists. And particularly, I think, its spirit exists. And its spirit particularly exists, I think, now in transition. As I said, I've worked with, or as Carolyn said, I've worked with transition in Seattle and Palo Alto and Santa Cruz. We have formed so many small groups. We started a lot in Seattle. We had something called Democracy Conversation. We have a garden circle. We have a transition cafe. And we are starting a sharing circle. And all of this going on in Seattle and in Palo Alto, my favorite one that we started was called Conversation, Community, and Calling, that we came together for each of us to talk about, you know, what is our calling, which is, again, top in being happy, and how can I create community to in the form of my calling? How can I use conversation? And it essentially, and we still get together and talk about this a lot, became a support group for activists, that you can come together with other people to talk about, you know, how do we do this, and get support, and we do this in the Palo Alto transition. And in Santa Cruz, again, we're starting a sharing economy circle. We'll come back, and I want us to talk a little more about the sharing because we're particularly focusing on that right now in Seattle. And this, I think, it's not directly a part of transition, but for most of us, it is a part of transition. So my argument basically is, you know, whatever else we're doing, you've got to create community. We've got to connect people with each other. We can't just have, you know, a business meeting where we talk about things and we don't have the personal side of it. We can't just go through our days lecturing to people about the problems of climate change. We've got to bring them together as we're doing in transition to help people get to know each other. As we're doing in sharing, you know, that we have a tool library and that we share what we do. But it all involves contact with each other. And in particular, my particular passion has always been the study circle and how do you bring people together to really study an issue in depth. We did a lot of voluntary simplicity study circles, and we're doing more conversation circles now. And there are three essential elements that you always need to start with the personal. Too often we come together and just start with the problem, the ideas. We have to get to know each other. I found a quote from Anne Morrill Lindberg, and she said, only when one is connected to one's own core is one connected to others. And then the second part of it is we have to do the critical thinking about of the role of the community. So let's say we're talking about community. The first thing we say is, when in your life have you had community? The second thing we say is, what in our culture is undermining community? Because we've got to look at the culture analysis instead of blaming the individual, as we've done so much in this culture. And then the third thing is always action. What actions can we take to create change? And the big thing there is that you have support, that people help you come up with ideas, that people support you in what you do, and that we had some simplicity groups just go on for years, and some of our sharing groups that we're starting are going on, and the transition groups keep going on. So what I want to do is stop here, and I would like to ask people what small groups they're involved in. And it can be in transition or it doesn't matter. In fact, it's interesting that it can be in a bridge club, which doesn't sound like it's going to help climate change very much. But anything that is a small group creates this feeling of empathy, creates this feeling of caring. And we not only care for people, but we tend to care then for the other species as well and to try to care about the planet. So I think, Carolyn, they just need to press 1 to put their hands up and maybe can tell us about a small group that they're involved in.
Yeah, so I invite you to press 1 on your keypads, and when I see that on the screen, I'll give you the mic. So don't be shy. Someone needs to break the ice.
Right.
So let us know. Linda, go ahead.
Okay, I'm going to break the ice.
Yay. Good for you.
I have been in a group that wasn't political or anything like that, but it was a craft group. And it started in my little community here of Kokomo. We meet in the community center, and it's, you know, supposed to be about people doing their crafts, and people would be knitting, crocheting, whatever. We have one man, token male, who did needlework. But the thing was, we met regularly, week after week, and we really did become close and enjoy each other's company and talk and laugh and, you know, really have a sense of you know, our little community there, little craft community. But I like to see those kinds of things grow, and usually I would want to talk about, you know, more pressing matters, and people wanted to keep it, you know, to the, I don't know, for me, mundane, I guess. So I'd like to know if there's a way to, you know, help people get beyond chit-chat.
Well, I think what you said, you brought up a really interesting issue. A lot of people say, why don't we figure out how to talk to people on the far right? What do we do to bridge the conversation? And I say, talking is not going to help. And this is one time I would say it doesn't help. Talking about issues doesn't help. What you do is you get to know them in one of the ways you've described, in a craft group, in particular when you're doing something. And I'm sure they know who you are and kind of what your concerns are, even if you don't talk about them all the time. And they, as they begin to care more for you, I think will become more open to your ideas. And so if, you know, if we were all involved in something like Habitat for Humanity or something, again, you're working with each other, you're doing something, and they kind of, and you don't have to talk about the issues, but it's almost osmosis that people begin to respect your issues because they care about you and respect you. And that's an interesting, is anybody else in something like a craft group or something that you feel you're not talking about the big issues, but you are making contact with people?
We do have some other hands up. So
okay.
let's go to Syl and then Barbara.
Okay. Well, We had started a small group using the game that I was talking about. Well, this game evolved because after Katrina, Hurricane Katrina, I needed some way to renew my business in New Orleans. And I'm related to Pocahontas, so I was aware that natives used to have medicine wheels, which are composed of concepts of the common good, like sharing and honesty and respect and so on, that they would dance to and therefore learn to embody these through sign language, and they would converse in this manner and have fun with it. And if you use your hands to do the simple sign language, then you can use the rest of your body to express yourself in your own individual manner concerning any concept that you, or problem that you have, any theme, address any theme, depending upon how you felt in your time frame and with your own individual ideas, but you're still being held in this common bonding set of concepts.
Is your game an online game, or is it something that people do
Still developing it, but there are three versions. One is online, another one is a game board, and another one is a dance, which is, well, the smallest version is a 4 foot in diameter, but the second is a 20 foot in diameter. And people, well, you can use a dodgeball too to learn one another's names. You have to call one another their name before you're allowed to hit them, and then the people, what's that?
I don't think going into a lot of detail right now, we don't have the time for it, but I appreciate that you've got something going, and it sounds like it can work on many levels. So back to you, Cecile.
Oh, I was going to say, please feel free to send me some description of it. I'd love to have it, and it's, Cecile@CecileAndrews.com. And then probably, Carolyn, we should go ahead and take another person and come back if we have the chance.
Yeah,
we have time.
Great. Perfect. Barbara, go ahead.
Hi, Cecile. This is Barbara Lutz.
Hi, Barbara. Yes, hi.
How are
you? So good to hear from you. Good to hear from you, yes.
You know, I think I mentioned this to you some years back, but for 4 years I did soup night here at my house once a week. I provided the soup and people brought salad or whatever. And everybody who came, it shrunk down to maybe 5 women, but they were all my friends and not friends with each other. And they're very, very diverse. Plus, I had a series of foreign students in and out of the house. Plus, when my children were home, college kids were in and out having soup. So it was a great mix for great discussion. There's no way that could stay chit-chat. And that worked for a while. What happened is, I was the catalyst because I'm the one who knew everybody. And even after all those years, I got burnt out. And so now I do it just once a month. None of the women have picked it up or anything like it on their own. And they don't socialize with each other, even to this day. So I was very discouraged. They have fond memories of it. They talk about it all the time. They tell people about it. But none of them initiate the action in any form on their own. So being a leader is, or initiating something is somehow not, trying to make sure you're not the person that everybody depends on for the event. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, and I just want to say, because Barbara helped us or did it, organize a lot of our Simplicity conferences over in Oakland and Berkeley. And I've heard about the soup nights, and I've always thought they were just absolutely wonderful. And she came up with some wonderful recipes. But I think she raises a really important issue that you can start something, but after a while, what happens in this culture is that it's almost like Americans get bored and that we're looking for the new thing, and that you almost have to come up with something new. And it's very strange. Like I said, you know, Barbara, how our voluntary simplicity circles went for years. And now the subject, voluntary simplicity, whereas a lot of people would agree with it, it doesn't excite people anymore. And, you know, that's why I think what transition does is in letting people come up with their own ideas, that it allows freshness to be there. And it keeps us from having the American boredom thing. But I think that you have to be careful that it doesn't wear you out and you don't burn out. And so when I do something, I try to, you know, like we have people over at our house, I try to make it very informal, let other people bring stuff, do as little of work as possible so that I don't burn out, but keep coming up with new ways to try to bring people together. But again, even if it changes, even if you get worn out, that's, you know, you've done something. And I thought, you know, the soup nights were wonderful. So again, thank you on that, Barbara. So another person?
No one has their hand up, but I wonder if we can just invite people now, if you have any questions or comments for Cecile in this whole realm, to press 1 on your keypad. And again, don't be shy. So surely there are questions or comments about having conversations and being in small groups.
Well, let me just say a few more things about the conversation.
There are,
you're somebody?
Yeah, we got hands,
okay.
Hands up now.
All right.
Lisa, go ahead.
Yes, thank you. I'm listening to this at a very opportune time. It's actually 10 minutes till 2 Central Standard Time, which is where I am located in the United States, and about a couple of hours from now, I'm going to be actually at a meeting that either may be the last meeting of Transition Central Arkansas or maybe the reinvigoration of it, and I'm hoping for the latter. We have had in this group, and I don't mean to dwell on this too long, but it may bear, some have some bearing on other types of groups as well, is that I'm middle-aged, and although I'm not retired completely, I have a project-based business, and everybody else pretty much is young. I mean, we're talking like 30, 35, most, you know, under 40 for sure. And like you said a while ago about people getting bored, we've done about 5 months of transition. We started meeting in February, and really we did a couple of things, but people became bored really quickly, and it was like they didn't really want to study transition. They didn't want to really learn about it. They just wanted to start doing things, which I know Rob Hopkins' new book is The Power of Just Doing Stuff. But somehow, even though we sponsored a permaculture film series, we had a booth at an Earth Day festival, this sort of thing, we never got off the ground as far as any kind of projects. So my question is more specific along those lines in terms of not only being, like you were saying a while ago, the leader who doesn't want to continue to keep, because I initiated the whole group, but I don't want to continue to do that, but we're losing numbers rapidly. It's like summertime and everybody wants to quote-unquote take off because it's summer. So I don't know how to keep it going and not wear myself out.
I know.
Lisa,
yeah.
I wanted to interject something too. This is Caroline. Often transition does get slow in the summer, so there is a natural pace there. So I'm just going to say that, and back to you, Cecile.
Well, I think that's a good point. And so you can respond to that and say, okay, let's take some time off in the summer. And everybody gets it. And then you start thinking about it. And then I think people start missing it. And they start realizing how important it is. We don't realize how important connection is with other people in this culture. And so then, you know, and then come up with something that's exciting to you. You know, we'll never do something really well unless we're really excited about ourselves. And so we change too. We're Americans too. We get bored too. We have to have the new thing. But I think that if we somehow, it's kind of like the craft group that was described, somehow that you build in getting, letting people get to know each other, that they will keep in touch. And even if they don't come up with an idea, you'll be able to do it. And I think that one of the biggest things that we have in this culture is not understanding how to have good conversation, that we don't realize that conversation is a barn raising. We see it too much as a battle, that people are trying to convince other people of things and argue things. No, you want people after they're talking with you to go away feeling really good about themselves and inspired and safe. And so, you know, see what you can come up with and keep trying something new. And you'll either bring in new people or you'll some of the other people will be rejuvenated. But it's, you know, as I say, we don't value this in this culture. So we find a way to almost trick people to get them to be involved, and then you just keep working. And I think you can see Robin Hopkins here, we're going to have another book out, and it keeps being re-envisioned, being done differently, because that's the way things work. So was there another hand up on anything?
Yes,
on
we do. We have Tina Clark. Go ahead, Tina.
Okay.
Hi, Cecil. I'm a big fan of yours from a long time ago.
Oh, good.
And I had a question. I also just wanted to say the person from Arkansas, I'm up in the Northeast, and we've had a lot of groups struggle like that. And we found that sometimes what helps is to do a forum or some kind of simple issue event followed by open space where people get together in small groups and carry on the conversations. That are a surefire way to kill a group is to try to have everybody keep meeting as one big planning group, and lots of people drop off like flies. So the key thing is to quickly get it into, you know, a small group, lots of small groups, like Cecil is saying, where people have different interests and don't all have to stay together in one big conversation that about logistics and administration and meeting times and stuff. Cecil, I wanted to ask you about, it feels like you have done such an amazing job of helping people connect emotionally, interpersonally. What do you do in groups when you've got some folks who really want to connect heart to heart and make that those friendships, and other people who have other kinds of conscious or unconscious agendas that they want the group to do certain things or to agree with them or to think certain ways or to have a platform for their pontifications about issues? And how do you, what have you found helps the heart? Are you saying that it's really good for people to try to stay heart-centered, at least in the beginning? And if you are, what are some tips on how to do that?
Well, I think the first thing, and I learned this after anything in one of my groups yelling at somebody, which is not a good group leader way to do things, but I realized that whenever you have a new group, start out with saying, okay, let's talk about what good conversation is. And everybody knows the answer to that. I don't have to do it. So they develop their own guidelines. And the guidelines usually go, the first thing is don't take too much time. And so people all bring that up, so we write that down. And another one is, you know, don't rant and rave. There's John Gottman, who writes a lot about relationships, says that don't develop a crabby habit of mind. And I love that. In other words, don't go complaining all the time about stuff. So we bring that up. And then people talk about, you know, don't try to convince other people of things. So essentially, you have people from the beginning always make up the rules, and you write them down, and that maybe every once in a while at the beginning, you know, you just go over them again. And then even though you're working with a small group, have people break up into pairs or small groups of three and talk that way, because then everybody gets a chance to talk, and it's usually the person who wants to pontificate can't do it as easily then. And if I see something developing, I'll immediately break people up into pairs or groups of three to talk, and that usually helps a lot. But it's not easy. But if we also become problem solvers, get people away from just what the idea is. What have you found in your life that makes a difference on this? And so that they tell the personal story. It doesn't necessarily, they don't have to reveal a lot. but they're very specific instead of just an idea. And then I was in this one thing that was really great, and it was called a brain exchange. And essentially, it's people brought different issues about how, you know, problems. Like one woman had just had a baby, and she wanted to know how to get back into her art. And so we all brainstormed. There was no feedback. You just brainstormed. And it was just wonderful because people had wonderful ideas, and you had to just say them. You couldn't go on and on, just a few things. So you just keep trying all these different things. And, I think doing things regularly every week is good, and let people know that they don't have to come every week, but they know we're there. It's almost like I think we can learn something from the way churches have been set up. It's there. It's there every week. We set up something in our neighborhood here in Seattle. It's a pub night. And say, okay, every Tuesday night, we just all show up at the pub. And some people will come and some people won't, but we're always there. And so having things be regular like that. And, you know, more and more ideas are coming out about how we can do this. So we can get discouraged, but I think we can find new ideas, and particularly in transition. And so with Rob Hoffman's new book, I think we'll get a lot of ideas. So any other responses, questions, comments?
There is. Barbara has her hand up. And I also wanted to mention, just because you've mentioned Rob a number of times, that he is coming to the U.S., so that will be also something to get to invigorate the whole movement around. So he'll be in the U.S. Late September and early October. So Barbara, over to you.
Hi, Cecile again. You've spoken to everything I was going to ask about or inquire. I think this book is on the hardest thing that our society can do. I really do. I think it's very, very tough for people to step out of their families and step out of institutions like Sunday church and reach out to people outside of those traditional avenues. So that's all. You've actually spoken to many of my questions already. Thanks.
But you just brought up something really important, this talking to somebody outside of our comfort zone. And again, that's why I like my small dog seduction, that you go through the day, and I have had such interesting conversations with people I would have never met in any of my political groups or my, you know, social change groups, because they just talked to me about my dog. And I found it so valuable, and I felt connected. And what we want to do, if we want social change, is that we need to evoke that caring for people we don't know. We have to evoke the caring for the stranger. And so I think what you just said was really important, that if we develop this idea that we're just going to talk to everybody, just go out through our day and do this, that you really will make contact with people you don't know. And then, as I say, you know, always have your little button that they'll see. We can wear it. We need a transition button. And I like the button, I'm changing the climate, ask me how. I think that we should all wear that, and that would get people's attention, and we could have such wonderful conversations over that, don't you think? So, yes. Anything else, Carolyn?
There's no other hands up. If someone has a burning comment or something to bring up, now is your last opportunity, and I don't see any. So, Cecile, just some closing comments, and I'll make a few comments, and then we'll adjourn for today.
Okay. All right. Well, I've, as I say, it's hard not to see you. It's hard not to connect with people in person, but I really want to thank Carolyn for doing this, because, again, it contributes to conversation and community, which contributes to the common good. And I think what we're doing is that we're taking seriously Margaret Mead's words, you remember, never doubt the ability of a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens to change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. And I think that's really, really true. And I think bringing people together about things that, like we're doing in Seattle, we're doing working hard on the sharing and not only letting people know about it, but getting involved in doing something. But essentially, that we need to help people realize that we're better together, that whenever we do something these days, don't just think about doing it on your own. Think about who can I do it with, who can I share it with, that when we all do better, we all do better, and together. And so somehow this is the cultural change that we're looking for and that we're beginning to think about the common good and the commons. And essentially, there's nothing that makes us happier, I think, than working with other people to change things. As I said, I really am enjoying working with Patrick, and I've loved working with Barbara. Some of my best times are when we're working with other people for something we believe in. So that's my final words, and so back to you, Carolyn.
Thank you so much, Cecile, for joining us today. I wanted to let people